The best ideas will win. It isn't a matter of great power. It's a matter of having the clearest image of the human soul, the clearest image of a historical goal that would be worthy enough to rescue meaning from the pyre of ruin that history is when you look back over it. All those pogroms, all those burning villages, those migrations, wars, and epidemics, those are our people back there. If it weren't for them, we wouldn't be here. The human enterprise does not exist to gutter out like a river flowing into a desert. We have to be smart. Obviously, there is a great crisis. Obviously, no one can speak in terms of anything we can conceive of existing on this planet 400 or 500 years from now. The historical neck is upon us. There is a concept. The concept of forward escape. This is what we need, a forward escape into another dimension. Now, perhaps it's off the planet. Perhaps it's into the bones of the planet. Perhaps it's into a parallel dimension. Perhaps it's forward into time, a million years. But we need, we must have, we will create this forward escape. It is the only possibility. It is not something to doubt. It is something to see as written in to the record of events as we behold it, the steady acceleration of novelty, the ever concressing and densifying of connectedness means that we are riding the forward crest of a kind of informational wave. And what history is a buildup of a kind of pressure. You know, in engineering school, they have what they call Q, vibration, as a structure approaches the speed of sound. And at the, right before you rupture the sound barrier, you are at max Q, and the airframe is bucking and threatens to pull itself apart. And then you slide through into the other dimension, where it is smooth as glass. And this is what the 20th century is. It is this enormous culmination to a thrust toward another world that began about 12, 15,000 years ago. It's a geological microsecond in which a species that was pawing for roots turns itself into some kind of archangelic, hyperdimensional creature that goes off into the realms of its own imagining. It is possibly the purpose of the planet. In any case, it is necessary for the planet as much as it is necessary for us. The metaphor that we should hold in our minds as we confront the chaostrophe of the late 20th century is the image of birth. It is bloody. It is messy. It does not look like part of the ordinary run-of-the-mill of how life works, but it is. It is the sine qua non. That means you can't get along without it. If the child and the mother are not parted at a certain moment, toxemia can set in. This threatens the life of the infant. It threatens the life of the mother. This is all part of nature. These microcosmic processes are repeated in the macrocosm of the life of the planet. We are that infinite, and we have come to terms. And what awaits us can hardly be imagined any more than a fetus can imagine being Ben Johnson. He looked good, I thought. So I said this was a message of hope. And it is, because I believe this process is built in. And that the way we can participate in it is by talking about it, by telling each other about it, by flexing the muscle of language to communicate with each other, to dispel the fear. This is the great weapon of simple people, is plain talk with each other. It's always plain talk that topples governments. Nothing else will do. It's always plain talk that brings on great new ideas. And plain talk is an art. It's an art that we all need to cultivate. It's the personal facet of this projection of a clear self-image. And plain talk empowers the felt presence of immediate experience. In fact, it's one of the best things you can do with immediate experience. It's amazing how the most intelligent of us go through the day basically communicating in grunts and groans. You know, I can be cleaning up my house and in the course of half an hour, Rome will fall and I will reinvent the polio vaccine in my mind. And if someone comes to the door and asks me what I've been doing, I say nothing. And I think everyone is like that. What the psychedelics argue, you see, is that we have universes of beauty and wonder and meaning locked up inside of ourselves, which we must find a way to share. And the only way we know is language and art and the transformation of language and art. And this is what we are called to grow closer to one another, to make ourselves part of this unitary entity. It was anticipated in the 16th century by the great alchemists. Then it was called the Philosopher's Stone. What we are moving toward is a concrescence of ourselves and our technology and our past and our future and our intentions that will allow us to do anything. I remember a very B film I saw many years ago, and the flying saucers were appearing all over the earth. And you didn't see the flying saucers, but you saw people planting rice in paddies in Asia, suddenly looking up at the sky and their eyes filling with tears and tears beginning to run down the wrinkled cheeks of these elderly Oriental women. And then it flashed to people in an African village pounding taro and then looking to the sky, and people in a huge modern city. This is the kind of singularity that I'm talking about, not piloted by friendly visitors from another world or unfriendly visitors from another world, but piloted essentially by the better half of ourselves, called by us from the future to join with us in rescuing the human and planetary enterprise through an act of understanding. Now, I've been accused of mysticism. And worse. But my image of the concrescence that culture is moving toward is something like this. It is the discovery of a principle or an attitude or a drug or a device. It doesn't really matter which. You can choose the metaphor that you like. A principle, an attitude, a drug, or a machine. But what's important is what it does. And what it will do is transmit information into the future. Send information into the future. And when I first imagined this device, most people, I think, would ask themselves, what would it be like at the other end where this information appears in the future? But what I wanted to imagine was, what would it look like in this laboratory when the first message was successfully transmitted to the future? Let's not call it a message, let's call it a person for the sake of imagery. So what would happen in this laboratory as the first time traveler is sailed off into the future? Well, now at first I thought that what would happen would be that suddenly all over the world time machines would appear, piloted by people from the future who had come to see the first time travel. Are you with me on this? But it tugged at my mind that there was something wrong with this, because, you know, when you talk about time travel, you must never have what's called the grandfather paradox. This is, if I go back in time and shoot my own grandfather, then I won't exist, so how could I shoot my own grandfather? And in any situation where this happens, you're in trouble. So the grandfather paradox would exist in that situation where time travelers suddenly appeared at the first time travel experiment from the future. So then I had a different notion, slightly, I hope, more profound, and it is this, that if a technology were to be invented that could send something or person into the future, and if in the process of inventing this thing, it were discovered that you can send a time machine forward in time, you can send it backwards in time, but you can never send a time machine further back in time than the invention of the first time machine. Why? Because before that, time machines didn't exist. That would explain why we don't see time machines. So I choose to believe, and will now attempt to convince you, that this is in fact the kind of universe that we are living in, and that what our technology is pushing toward is the invention of some kind of something which, in real plain talk, is a time machine. In slightly less plain talk, what is happening is that this concrescence, this singularity, this knitting together of everything is approaching the point where it can no longer be any more knitted together unless it expands into the future. You follow? In other words, it's becoming so complexified that it's requiring another dimension for its own self-description, and the only dimension available to it is the future, and so it's beginning to move into this other dimension, and we, standing in the macrocosm looking at this process, say, oh, someone has invented a time machine, but this is how it would work. What's interesting about this idea is that if such a thing were to be created by any means, the effect would be to cause the entire rest of the future to happen almost instantly. In other words, like heat distributing itself through a gas, the most advanced states that can possibly exist in the future lie just on the other side of this technological barrier of sending a person or thing into the future, because the most advanced state flows back through the system and converts all pre-existing states to itself. So So this is, to me, very interesting. It means, in a way, that we can toil toward a kind of psychotechnological switch, which, if thrown, emerges us in Bodhi mind, emerges us in the highest hypostatization available to the religions of our planet, the white light, the Bodhi mind, whatever you care to style it. It actually may exist ahead of us in the historical continuum. And of course, as in quantum physics, where particles can penetrate energy barriers and appear on the other side without actually having attained energy sufficient to go over the barrier, this is called virtual tunneling, information can make its way into the past, even our past, to a very slight degree. This is what has created these psychedelic visions, these religious hierophanies. They are the products of advanced human personalities, holy men and women, staring at their minds in states of deep contemplation and anticipating the destiny of the human race, the destiny of biology on this planet. And I think that we are very close to being able to cross through the membrane and realize this eschatological possibility, to cross into a new ontos of being, the ontos of being that has called us forth across the millennia, out of the scattered jarring of the atoms, into organic existence, up through the cultural experience, across the horrific leap of history, and into authentic meaning. This is what the shamans have been seeing for thousands and thousands of years,